Titans, go! Again, everyone, welcome to Titan Talk, the Titans podcast. I'm one of your co-hosts, Charles Skaggs, back in Doom Manor at least one final time for now, hopefully not too long. And of course, I'm joined by my wonderful co-host, great friend, and kind of a bittersweet, melancholy co-host, DJ Nick. How are you doing, Nick?
Hey, Charles. Yes, indeed, it is a little bit. Like, I could almost hear sort of Bittersweet Symphony playing in the background, you know, when you hear the strings start off, yeah. That's right, yeah, and I'm never going to get that out of my head, and I apologize to listeners for the earworms if you're not fans of that song. I'm always super happy to talk to you, and, you know, really looking forward to naturally reviewing this episode, but of course I'm a little bit sad because this is the final episode of Season 2, because as we have discussed over the course of this season review, we got cut short. We kind of got shortchanged here a little bit. Obviously not because of anybody's fault, but aside from Mr. Coronavirus, but yeah.
Corona shakes fist. So yes, here at episode 59, Nick and I are finally talking Wax Patrol, the season 2 finale of Doom Patrol, episode 9, which, you know, should have been the penultimate, but no, we were cut short an episode. And this was released on August 6, 2020, written by Chris Dingus, who wrote the previous episodes Cult Patrol, Hey, Penultimate Patrol, and Finger Patrol from this season, and also Tanya Steele, who I still think is related to Cliff. I'm just putting that out there, who wrote the previous season 2 episode Sex Patrol, which was so much fun to talk about. And this episode, directed by Christopher Manley, who directed the previous episodes Doom Patrol, and the season 2 opener Fun Size Patrol. So at least he got to kind of bookend his season a little bit, even with that short, abbreviated season that we got. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Unfortunately, yeah, this wasn't the finale that we wanted. It's a little frustrating, especially as we get to the cliffhanger, because which should have led into a much bigger finale. But it's all we get for now, and we'll just have to kind of take it on its own and be thankful and hopeful that we'll get a season 3, and we'll eventually see the resolution when it comes back on HBO Max.
I certainly hope so, Charles. I mean, you know, you kind of have your ear to the ground, as it were, when it comes to this stuff. So far, there have been no announcements, correct?
Yeah, I was obviously with the DC Fandom online event that happened this past weekend, we were kind of hoping that we might get a season 3 announcement, but a lot of the TV show panels have been held off until September, and I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in our news section. So we didn't get the announcement. We didn't get the Doom Patrol panel that was originally planned, although it's still on. It's still being planned in September. So hopefully, maybe, you know, here in a few weeks when DC Fandom returns for the TV panels and some DC Comics panels, that we'll finally get that season 3 announcement. Fingers crossed.
We definitely hope so. Hopefully we can shake off those summertime blues to some good news.
Yeah, because I'm guessing, yeah, I see what you did. Very nice. But and it rhymed, too. I'm guessing they got to at least have something to announce during the Doom Patrol panel. So we just have to hope and wait and see, because we need some more Doom Patrol. But until then, yes.
Yeah, we certainly do.
And so until then, we got to talk the finale because, you know, there's a lot going on in here, especially a lot going on with Miranda in this episode. We get a lot of backstory with her. We also kind of get the sort of origin of Crazy Jane, I think. And that's something I want to talk about with you. And we get some guest cast in this one. Just most notably, you know, we get kind of the return of Pasei Pau as Slava. We get the return of David McDonald as Daddy. Phil Morris comes back, but this time not as Silas Stone, but as Dr. Cowboy.
Yeehaw.
Which should have been the identity of Matt Smith in a town called Mercy, I'm just saying.
Agreed.
Dr. Cowboy. And but we get Joshua Michael as imaginary Jesus, and which was, I'm sure, a very controversial character for a lot of people.
We will have to talk about that, Charles, because I do have some questions when it comes to controversy in the U.S.
Oh, yeah. So Joshua Michael had appeared. He's got a pretty good comic book TV resume. He was in episodes of Black Lightning. He was in the movie Ant-Man and the Wasp, had a cameo in that. And he was also a little minor character, a recurring character called Jared on The Walking Dead.
Ah, okay. So yeah, I don't watch The Walking Dead, so I wouldn't know, but I'll have to keep my eyes peeled for when we review Ant-Man and the Wasp on Happiness and Darkness for sure.
Yeah, yeah. I think he plays a guard or something, you know, so it's not very heavy, but he's in it. So
I'll keep my eyes peeled saying, hey, I saw Jesus.
Jesus, hey, what are you doing in this movie? And Jesus in the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
It can happen, folks.
Which wouldn't surprise me, you know. Now we can finally get that Jesus versus Thanos fight we've been waiting for. Ooh.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
My money's on Jesus. Just saying. All right. We have four topics today because we have a lot to talk about. So let's dive right in. Topic number one, let's talk about Miranda. Johnny Bills, this guy that she was kind of shacking up with when she was Miranda, when Jane was Miranda. And the origin of Crazy Jane, because as we see through the flashbacks in this episode, Kay Chalice, who is now being driven by the persona Miranda at this point in her, you know, young adult, gets involved with this guy and goes through a rather traumatic experience on top of her other traumatic experiences, which are numerous. And as a result, I think this there's a definite shift in the primary paradigm where Jane emerges for the first time. And so we kind of get that story in this one. So what did you make of the downfall of Miranda and the rise of Jane in these flashbacks?
It was, I love the fact that we actually got to see Miranda's origin story, if you will, or the fact that, you know, obviously, because when we left her, she was the primary.
Yeah.
I never thought this would be her origin story. It was a nice story. It was an interesting story. But I just wouldn't expect it from her. But because,
it's the sweet, loving tale of a guy that she gets involved with who wants to have an orgy.
Yeah, exactly. Plain and simple. You know, put it out there.
You know, it's ripe for a Disney movie. I'm just saying.
Oh, yeah, it's perfect. You know, put it on Disney Plus tomorrow. Yeah, see how that one works out for you, Disney. What I thought was interesting, I wonder where is Johnny Bills a character in the comics or is he made up for the show?
No, this was something that the show invented.
Okay, because I wonder where the writers are fans of Johnny Cash, and it might be, you know, their version of Johnny Cash, like dollar bills, and so they went with Johnny Cash.
Oh, I see. I never made that connection. That's awesome. That's great that you spotted that. I think you're absolutely right with that.
It could be. I mean, we'll have to, you know, since you seem to be getting a lot of interest from the writers, some of the writers of Jupiter, you should probably write to them and say, are you guys fans of Johnny Cash?
I'll just call up my buddy Shoshana Sachi. And
there you go.
Ask her, you know, hey, show.
How's it hanging?
What's up? What's up? You know, so this Johnny Bills thing, was that, you know, kind of like a nod to Johnny Cash? We'll see what no, I'm just kidding. She's retweeted me like twice, I think. I don't know. So,
well, hey, you never know. I'm just saying, you know, that door might be open. But I guess, you know, because I thought, aside from the name, I suppose he is very much, you know, kind of a Dylan-esque kind of character, because he almost seems to be imitating Bob Dylan's style, very much like that folk guitarist. You know, also the way he sings almost sounds a little bit like Bob Dylan. And at first, like, this guy must be a really sweet chap. He must be like a really nice guy, you know, because apparently he seems to be kind of serenading her, if you will, even though she does pay him. But
right.
But he does seem to really have a thing for her. And I guess she's very naive in that sense, because maybe she doesn't know about love. You know, kind of get that sort of that innocent girl who's corrupted, if you will, by this man who wants to have an orgy. Now, what I thought was about this, you know, because I had thought to myself, how do I talk about this without sounding either politically incorrect or, you know,
yeah,
or too PC? Because here's the thing. I have worked in the rock music business, and I have been to quite a few crazy parties. So I've seen some serious stuff go down.
Ooh, let's tell me more.
maybe someday I'll tell you some of the things I've seen. But so I wasn't fazed by it. And obviously, you know, if you want to swing, you're welcome to swing. You know, nobody's right. going to judge you for that. But the thing is, you should kind of tell your girlfriend or fiance or what have you, this is what I had in mind. Are you down with this? Because that's what I think was Johnny's mistake, is he did not tell her. Because you think, oh, they're probably going to have a very easy party, you know, just friends coming over, hanging out, having a couple of drinks. And it turns out to be what it is. And obviously, I think this whole thing could have been avoided if he told her from the get-go, look, I want to kind of explore, you know, certain avenues when it comes to my sexuality. Are you cool with this? So, and that was his big mistake. I think rather than maybe her being so upset about it and going on the whole thing of they were.
Yes.
That was a question of get consent before you do this stuff. I don't think, because they're not raping you, they're not drugging you to have sex with you. It's not a Rohypnol situation.
Yeah.
So that was my thought on it, because like I said, I'm very open about this stuff. You know, you can do whatever you want within reason, and as long as it's consensual.
Right. Consent is very important, people. Let's just put that right out there, you know, for exactly. everyone, you know, there's no mistake on this one. Consent. Pay attention to it.
So that was my thought.
So my, you know, the impression I got from Johnny was that I don't see him as making a mistake so much as this was his plan all along, because he talks about he has these friends and, you know, so presumably, you know, he knows these people pretty well. He knows what they're mm-hmm. into. And I get the feeling, at least the feeling from this episode, that this wasn't his first time. Okay. So my take is that he was, you know, like he knew what he was doing. He figured, well, you know, I can persuade her to go along with this. Being confident enough in himself that, you know, look, hey, you know, it's 1969, free love, baby, free love. And he, you know, keep in mind, I'm born in 69. I'm just saying, but I'm a product of said free love. And, you know, I probably figured, well, you know, I can kind of start her off with just, you know, like, hey, we'll do a little swinging at first and that'll kind of break the ice. And then that will, you know, once that goes, then that'll ease her transition her right into the orgy with everything else going on. So I kind of see this, at least the way I took this was that he was orchestrating this. He was confident he could just like talk to her and make it happen. And this was going to happen no matter what. This wasn't just some like, oops, you know, hey, I didn't know my friends were going to bring over an orgy.
No, of course I don't think he was playing dumb with her, but I think of that he but you know, you said that talk, he didn't have the talk with her evidently.
No. And you know, obviously that's, you know, let's take into consideration Jane or rather Miranda at this point, because Miranda, she's obviously very mentally troubled. This isn't, you know, this isn't Kay Chalice in this situation. This is Miranda, one of her alternate personas that has taken over, and because of all the childhood drama that Kay went through as the result of sexual abuse of her from her father.
Sure.
So she's already troubled. And now granted, maybe Johnny didn't know all this was going on with Miranda. Presumed that Miranda was exactly what she appeared on the surface. But if he had, you know, obviously been a little more aware of someone other than himself, and actually talk to her about this and say, hey, look, I'm kind of into this, like you said, maybe slip her the note. Do you want to have an orgy? Check yes or check no.
It's as simple as that.
Exactly. So, you know, to talk to her first before this happens. But like I said, he doesn't care. At least that's the impression that I got. He doesn't care. He was going to make this happen no matter what.
Yeah, I mean, it's all about selfishness in this case. I think rather than being, you know, a creep or anything like this, he's being selfish, pure and simple. He wants to do what he wants to do. And like in a few relationships I've seen, it's all about him and it's not about her. Or in other cases, it's all about her and it's nothing about him. So I think it's a very one-sided relationship in that case. I do think he loves her, but he is also incredibly selfish as well.
Yeah, and obviously when her persona emerges at the end of this episode in these flashbacks, she calls him right out in front of everybody about his selfishness and about his attitude and people, men like him, and that they think that they can just, you know, pressure women into these situations that they want to be pressured into.
Yeah.
And coming from, like, I think the writer is writing this from a modern standpoint and applying it to 1969. You know, seems a little, you know, a little too forward, a little too progressive for the time period. But when you're considering the viewers watching it, I think it needed to be said.
Yeah, you need to watch it with 2020 eyes. I wonder whether there is a little bit of Me Too in that, if you will.
Yeah, I think there is. But I think that kind of needed to be stated given everything else going on. You know, that totally. That Jane needed to make a statement, especially that, you know, I think it was a pretty powerful statement.
It was. I mean, it's correct. I mean, I agree they had to have her say that whole thing of this is not cool.
Right.
You know, it's, you know, we went back to the whole thing of consent. If there is zero consent and you're being pressured into situations which, like you said, are not comfortable with, you know, that's just not how it works. And you make a great point on that. What I did think was curious was, how then, you know, and Jane is kind of catapulted it directly into this situation. Granted, we see that while she is having sex, multiple personalities take over. And in fact, we actually see, I think, Scarlett Harlott smoking at one point. So she enjoyed herself. No surprise.
Exactly. But I do. I think that's where I think this whole orgy sequence, this is where essentially it's the origin of Crazy Jane. That maybe, you know, until this moment, it was maybe just the Miranda persona. She was more of just a split personality. But here, this is full-on dissociative identity disorder at this point, where, you know, that small crack in Jane's psyche has now splintered into an entire web of cracks and all the 64 different personalities.
I think so, yeah. It's almost like they were being conceived right then and there.
Kind of,
you kind of watch the conception and the birth.
In the orgy, yeah, exactly. They were birthed. That's a great metaphor there. I agree with that, totally. I think they were born in that moment.
Because of obviously, you know, being what it was. Also, outside of that, I guess I was kind of a little bit disappointed, as I said, by this guy, because I'm like, you know, finally some happiness happens to Miranda. And
yeah.
Obviously, something bad had to happen because we had to realize why Miranda was the way she was.
Yeah.
And why she threw herself into the well, because we did not know what caused her to ultimately kill herself.
Yeah, that's another story that we get in this is that, you know, that Miranda, through this, emerges in the underground. And some of the other personalities, the personas, aren't happy with her. The secretary kind of like tells Miranda that she was supposed to keep them safe and failed at her job. And so she, you know, she tries to talk to Kay about it in this really great moment where, you know, Miranda inside Jane's head finds Kay in her room and tries to apologize to Kay. But Kay is having none of it. She's giving zero Fs at this point and locks her out. And so Miranda despairs at this point, and she essentially gives up and throws herself in the well.
And in fact, we find out that who we thought was Miranda is not Miranda. And
yes.
That was like a big reveal.
That's a fantastic segue, because that was definitely the next thing I want to talk about. So we get to at the end of the episode. We see Kay talking to, you know, in the present, talking to Miranda and getting suspicious because now Jane has gone missing,
yeah,
as well as Lucy Fugue and others. And so she gets a suspicion. She talks to Miranda at one point and goes, "You're not really Miranda, are you?" And Miranda replies, "No." And Kay goes, "Who are you?" And then, you know, the penny drops at this point, and you hear those creepy, creepy words, "Sweet, sweet baby."
Mm-hmm. Is it just me, or was that another Bob moment from Twin Peaks, Charles?
Yeah. So, you know, I know a lot of people out there haven't seen Twin Peaks, but...
in fact, I don't want to ruin it for them, but I don't think it's a big spoil.
But the comparison is pretty valid, because in this instance, what appears to be is that the daddy persona in Jane's head, the one that was lurking in the well, that everyone was afraid of coming out, is the one who came out in his disguise now as Miranda, and is going through the motions of disposing with the other personalities by throwing them down the well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because then it actually cuts to Jane seeing Miranda's corpse.
Yeah, because Jane is in the well, and she goes down there and she sees this light, and then turns out it's Miranda, that necklace. And then she reaches down for that and, you know, pulls at the necklace, and up comes Miranda's decomposed body in the well. So essentially what happened was that, Miranda, you know, has died for all intents and purposes, but Daddy has come out and has assumed her form and has taken over in the plot to destroy the others and seize control.
Which is wow.
Which is horrible, like, right?
Yeah, but it was like, once again, this episode had all the trappings of a, pre-finale, if you will, penultimate episode, because you have that in the mix. There's other stuff in the mix. You're like, why? You know?
Wait, and that's a great cliffhanger to end a season on.
It's fantastic.
So, yeah, I mean, it's very powerful, and it's something, obviously, that a lot of people are going to be, like a lot of Doom Patrol fans, like the both of us, are going to be like waiting with bated breath. I was like, okay, so Jane's got to come out of the well, right? And she's going to be the one to stop the daddy persona, yeah, right? Yeah. So how does that happen? When does that happen? Because I need to watch that like yesterday.
You and me both. I mean, because there's so much going. It's so just turmoil everywhere. There's turmoil in the underground. There's turmoil in the real world. It is just all around, you know, kind of an apocalyptic scenario all over.
Yeah, this is going on top of everything else, and oh hey, the world ending potentially.
Just that.
Yeah, NBD, right? No big deal. So I can't wait. I want more Doom Patrol. This is one of the frustrating things about this episode is that, well, we could have got at least one more episode to find out a little bit more of what happened, but now we have to wait.
It's like they're making that cake, you know, they give you the spoon to taste the batter, but you don't get to taste the cake just yet.
No. Apparently the cake has been, you know, it was baked in the oven and then locked away in a freezer with an unknown time release date. So
and all you got was this spoon with of icing,
yeah,
as it were.
Yeah, exactly. You know, and it's already gone. So you're just like, you're holding the spoon going, but.
Yeah, that's how bad it is.
Yeah, exactly. So so it's very frustrating, but it's a great cliffhanger, like you were talking about. Mm-hmm. And I can't wait to see what happens.
I mean, what was your reaction, Charles, when we got the reveal that Daddy is alive and well and pretty much invading the underground?
Well, I kind of had I watched it and it didn't quite process in my head. I knew what had been said, but I kind of second guessed myself. I was like, did I hear that right? And I rewound it and I was just like, oh my God. So very cool idea.
So you were genuinely surprised?
Yeah, I was genuinely surprised. I didn't, you know, I kind of thought that Miranda would just be evil and seeking to take control, as we've talked about here on the podcast, but to have the reveal be that it's the daddy persona, the one that was lurking in the well all this time, making his move at last. And
it was great because it wasn't just a predictable, if you were, I'm just going to take over.
Yeah, you know, I thought it'd be a little more paint by numbers, but apparently not. And I'm glad about that. It raises the stakes, I think, a little bit.
Oh, very much so. In the middle of everything, because obviously it does. What I love the fact that they haven't even dealt with the candle maker yet, and there's already stuff to deal with elsewhere too. That's what I think is great, because it's they could have easily done. We get over the candle maker thing, and then we address Miranda. And I'm glad they made it more lifelike. If you was stuff can happen all at once in life. You know, you can have one cataclysm and then immediately followed by another one. So I
oh,
do
yeah,
like
I
that.
Know. Trust me on this. Yes. Yeah. I've been kicked down multiple times at same point in time. So yeah, I can relate to that. So yeah.
And when it rains, it pours, as they say.
Generally, yes. But we'll see what happens. All right. Anything else about this topic before we move on?
No, I think we pretty much covered everything. It was just really an interesting thing. I also like the once again, the photography is brilliant in this show. Mm-hmm. The way that the 60s period was shot was really, really good, because the colors very much remind me a little bit of Mindhunter, if you will, when it came to the colors used.
Exactly. Yeah, that kind of muted, definitely a 70s period vibe, early 70s, late 60s. So, yeah, the color, I think the costuming, the setting, the sets were on point. Definitely. And just needed that great Mindhunter soundtrack to go with it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we know how good that soundtrack
is. Maybe throw on the Police's Darkness for that track. It would have been pretty good. Or, yeah, so, you know. Anyway, big fans of Netflix's Mindhunter, just saying. All right. Topic number two. Let's talk, as heavy as that first topic was, let's talk a little something lighter. Let's kind of lighten the mood a little bit. So let's talk Father of the Bride. Cliff Steele, Robot Man, as he prepares for his daughter's wedding.
Oh, yeah.
Which, as we talked to him when we talked Dad Patrol last week, Cliff had finally been asked by Clara, hey, you know, he got the invite to her wedding, something he was dreaming about ever since he found out that she was going to be married and having a baby and whatnot. So he is head over heels about this. And this is all he's got complete tunnel vision with this. This is all he's fixated on. But as you said, life is what happens when you're busy making other plans. And there's a slight apocalyptic crisis in the making, which is kind of derailing his plans a bit. So I know you're a big Robot Man fan.
I love that man, yeah.
So just why don't you go ahead and express your poor sympathies for our beloved brain in a nutrient tank.
I love that. Well, first off, while I reiterate my need and desire for a Robot Man Funko, I needed that yesterday, as you would say, Charles.
Yes.
I definitely want a Robot Man Funko.
You and me both, and, brother.
Yeah, and have like the eyes light up and everything. They've done that, so I'd love to
have
that.
Oh, that would be cool, yeah.
Yeah, because they actually have, to go on a brief tangent, they actually have a Mysterio Funko, which actually has the bulb that lights up, which is really cool.
Oh, now I want that. I didn't know that. That's cool. I didn't know it lit up.
Yeah, there's actually a little switch that you press, and the fishbowl turns
dome.
On.
Yeah.
So I'd love if they did that with Robot Man Funko. But outside of that, you know, I was hoping he would go for the tux, and Larry has my idea on this. He's like, "You're going to be wearing a t-shirt." I'm like, "Well, why are you wearing a t-shirt, dude? Come on." But
step your game up, Cliff.
Yeah, of course, everybody's going to be looking at the bride. Larry's very diplomatic in that moment.
Pragmatic, yeah. He's like, we're not going to get him in a tux. But how great would it be to see Cliff in a tux? We talked about that a little bit, but...
Yeah, he would have been so sharp-dressed. See, if you could have, there's another Funko I would love you as a variant. You can have Cliff in a tux. That would be very cool. But yeah, he's so excited. He's going through his T-shirts. And, I mean, I would actually like to see Cliff's T-shirt collection, because there must be some seriously crazy T-shirts the man owns. I just was so happy from...
They're mostly
like
Rock Band T-shirts, by the way.
Yeah, all ones with incredibly, you know, coarse phrases on them.
Yeah.
But what I thought was, as you said, he does have tunnel vision. That's very well said, because all he can think about is that. And even when crisis comes calling, he's like, no way I'm going to be a part of saving the world. I need to be at my daughter's wedding. He so wants to be there. And I am afraid if and when we do get a season three, that his daughter might not either believe him or might not forgive him or what have you for not being there. And I just hope it doesn't cause a rift between the two because she doesn't know. Because he called her saying he had other stuff to do. Would it have been too much for him to say, I'm off to save the world?
Right, exactly. It's like, I'm kind of a superhero. That's kind of what I do. So,
at that point, she could believe him.
The reason that you're actually still here is because of me and my friends. So you would think he would kind of get a pass maybe, but, from her perspective, how do you prove that?
That's the whole thing. And she's been let down before and she knows his track record.
Exactly. He's got a history of disappointing her.
That's why I'm worried if in the long run, once things get resolved, we'll see how they get resolved when if they do. But I have a feeling it might cause a rift and we might go, you know, he's taken quite a few steps forward. He'll end up taking a lot of steps
back. Might be a setback. Yeah, might be a setback.
That's what I'm concerned about the most. Because he so wants to be there regardless. Yeah. You know, like literally the world could come to an end, but he wants to be by his daughter's side. And I can't blame him because he wants to be with the one he loves. And, you know, granted, you have to look at the bigger picture and you have to look at saving the world. But he said, you know, this is all about Chief's daughter. Why can't I deal with the mess that I made and be there for my daughter? That's my view on it. Charles, what did you make of it?
Well, you know, obviously it's definitely a concern. Part of me is still hoping that Jane will get back in charge and Flit could teleport Cliff to the wedding.
Oh, that's a good idea. True. Yeah, there is that.
Of course, he might have to get reassembled first. So,
yeah, there is that.
Yeah, we'll talk about that a little bit more. But that could be a slight difficulty to overcome. I'm just saying. All right. So it was fun. You know, it's fun to see Cliff, you know, like he's going through his T-shirt collection with Larry, like you were talking about. Basically, he says he's like kind of making an effort. He's like, well, I'll try to choose the one that's the least offensive. Yeah. So,
and the most clean, apparently.
And the most clean. So, okay, I'm sure that's appreciated, right? So, considering what it could be. But obviously it's not ideal. And poor Larry is just like, why are you even bothering? Why? At this point. But Herschel the spider shows up. That the imaginary creature that Dorothy had created, one of her imaginary friends, and one of the good ones, at least, and warning of, you know, essentially there's, you know, candelapocalypse.
Nice. I like that.
And, you know, this needs to be, you know, like we need to save Dorothy. And poor Cliff is coming at this going, look, I hate the chief. I got my daughter's wedding to focus on right now. I don't care about the chief. You know, like, he can be responsible for the kid he effed up. I'm going to be responsible for the kid I effed up. And that's that. So he has to kind of be persuaded in this case that by Rita, if, of all people, going, look, if you want to be the man that Clara wants you to be, then you need to help Dorothy. And Cliff doesn't really have a good comeback for that one.
No. And Rita's really coming into her own as a leader, I think.
Which is good. I mean, because right now I think they need it, especially with the chief off, you know, doing other things and, you know, just the nature of the team that they could use that, really. So Cliff makes that phone call to Salty's bar, leaves another voice message because he's so good at these voice messages, right? Yes.
You think with a couple of kind of selfies and thing he'd done, record messages, he would have gotten some practice. Granted, he didn't have to say one love, but I mean, he could have done something better.
Exactly. You know what he should do? He should just record these in advance and just, you know, hold a recorder up to the phone when he needs them, you know, for a specific moment. Yeah. Like, you're like, okay, come up with a write-up, you know, like a pre-recorded, like, hey, I'm sorry, I'm not going to be able to make blank event, but... But something weird has come up with the Doom Patrol, so I'll catch you on the flip side, right? And so, you know, he calls Clara up, says he's going to have to miss the wedding. He apologizes and says that he'll be there for his grandson's birth. But the question is, will she let him be there for that birth? As you pointed out.
That's the big question. That's the big question. I mean, and like you said, in how many pieces is he going to be there?
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, I'm sure that's going to make it easier to ship him. You know, you could just do it, just bundle up in several boxes and kind of like, you know, like essentially like going to IKEA. You assemble your own father out of a like a kit.
But see, and then you could have your favorite seven moment. What's in the box? What's in the box?
Well, exactly. If you have that headpiece, especially going, and you like, you know, you open the box and you do a nice little seven nod, and there's Cliff's head inside going like, "How you doing?" Or "What the F?"
See, you could even tribute seven in with this.
Yeah, so a little more animated than Gwyneth Paltrow's head, so
Yeah.
just a bit, just a bit, but could be just as fun.
For
All
sure.
right, all right. Anything else about this topic?
I think that's pretty much it. It's just so frustrating for poor Cliff that
Yeah.
he's reached his moment of happiness and it gets taken away from him.
It's just not that easy for poor robot man, is it?
It ain't easy being a robot man, I guess.
Exactly. It ain't easy. No. All right, topic number three, imaginary friends. So let's talk about Dr. Cowboy, Mademoiselle Roxy, and imaginary Jesus. So, this is going to be a tricky topic, I think,
It will be.
but I think it's going to be a lot of fun as a
Oh,
result.
sure.
So essentially what we have is, you know, Cliff and the Doom Patrol are riding to the rescue. You know, they go to the street fair where the chief is there with Dorothy at the mercy of the Candlemaker. And they show up, they meet Willoughby Kipling for a bit. Once again, Willoughby Kipling completely useless.
Really?
Just want to point that out. It's kind of a trend at this point that he's going to be ultimately pretty useless.
He's
And
good with colorful insults, though.
he is, you know, he throws off a good one-liner here and there, but when it comes to actually helping out, not that great. Not that great. But so they meet him, and then they find out from Willoughby Kipling that, well, hey, you know, the Candlemaker's loose. He got some imaginary friends. There's one that apparently is a Punch doll, you know, like a Punch and Judy doll that was Willoughby's imaginary friend as a child at some point. And that one kind of like drags him off screen. So apparently there's more. And we find out that Vic's imaginary friend was Dr. Cowboy. Kind of a cowboy-like character, but who looks exactly like Vic's father, Silas. And so, of course, we have, like I said, we have what's his name? Phil Morris playing the role, and then we have Mademoiselle Roxy, who was a paper doll that Rita had as a child, and apparently got rid of, as we find out through the course of this story. And then imaginary Jesus. Simply because Cliff was at Bible camp for like a summer and apparently imagined hanging out with Jesus during that summer a little bit. So what did you make of the Doom Patrol meeting their imaginary childhood friends?
Okay, so before we address the Nazarene in the room,
I see what you did there. I see what you did there.
what I wanted to say when it came to, well, Dr. Cowboy, I thought was an interesting one,
Yeah.
as
Why
in.
don't we tackle these one at a time?
Yeah, I'm going to take them apart a little bit because, you know, I think they are worth spending a few words on.
Yeah.
It's interesting that, you know, that we get to find out that basically how attached Vic is to his dad, to the point to where his imaginary friend looks like him. So it's almost like that's how much he idolizes him. And the fact, I guess, of being a doctor, which is, of course, you know, Silas's profession. Except Vic wanted to make him a cowboy, which I thought was curious. A cowboy with test tubes instead of guns, which was interesting. It's like, okay, so how's this guy going to help you in a fight or whatever? I don't know. He's going to throw test tubes at you? I don't know. But it was great. It was good fun.
When he's got pistols with sulfuric acid. Pew, pew, pew. I
It
don't know.
could be that. It was. I never would have expected that. But I'm assuming then, if he was a fan of cowboys, either Vic enjoys country music or he's a big fan of westerns. One of the two.
I'm thinking the westerns. We haven't really seen, if nothing else, we saw Vic earlier in this episode moping in his room listening to The Cure.
Yeah, so I don't see him.
So I don't see music. I don't see country music. No, no, I can't see, because country music fans and Cure fans don't exactly mesh well together.
No, they do not. But what I thought was odd, because I don't know how old Vic is, because the cowboy era, I think, was way before his time, when you had the silver screen cowboys, you know, whether it be the spaghetti westerns of the 60s, or even further back, you know, we had the John Waynes, yeah, or those.
Well, he might have seen a movie on TV, you know, as a rerun.
Very probable. Or Silas himself is a fan of Western movies, and he watched them because Silas was a fan of those films.
Maybe. Yeah, it is something I don't think we'll ever find out, but I think it is pretty curious that, you know, like a kid from Detroit would be into cowboys.
But then again, I suppose they were the thing. But like I said, if you may be a kid growing up, yeah, in the 60s, when it was all the era of the spaghetti westerns, or like I said earlier before, when you had folks like Gene Autry or these kind of people, it would, yeah, make sense.
Or maybe his dad took him to see Silverado or Tombstone as a kid.
Could very well be. I mean, it's also almost odd, kind of the fact, because the space age became the next craze for people. You know, it's like just like what Toy Story teaches us, is the cowboys were wiped out by the spacemen.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's almost a fun contrast that a kind of a spaceman, if you will.
I love that you brought Toy Story in as an argument.
Well, that's how much I love Toy Story. I'm a huge, huge fan of Toy Story.
Fair enough.
But I think that's why I think it's almost curious that a cyborg, if you will, a Buzz Lightyear, actually almost enjoys Woody's
being a Woody. Yeah, it's you have Buzz Lightyear wanting to be a Woody.
Yeah, that's why I think it's weird, but yeah, it was fun. What did you make of Dr. Cowboy, Charles?
I thought it was interesting. You know, I didn't really think it like you did. You really dug deep into that one. That was interesting.
As soon as I overthink stuff, that's my problem.
But I think what it was is Dr. Cowboy is essentially a representation of Vic's daddy issues. You know, that his dad wasn't around. So he imagined a dad that would be around, and hey, we're just going to make him cool. So why can't he be a cowboy too? So apparently that was, you know, Vic's imaginary friend growing up. The two kind of sit down and talk a little bit. At first, you know, we're not quite sure what to make of Dr. Cowboy. He seems very friendly, very outgoing, but obviously that's going to, you know, that what we don't really think about is that, well, this is a creature being created by the Candlemaker. So essentially it's the Candlemaker talking to Vic here through this Dr. Cowboy creation. So he's essentially manipulating Vic that, you know, he says, you know, he talks, the Dr. Cowboy talks about that he's there to help Vic with his female problems, meaning Ronnie, of course, because as we saw earlier in the episode, that Vic is feeling very despondent over breaking up with Ronnie and how everything went down, so that, you know, he essentially Vic tries to turn to Dr. Cowboy, someone he trusts, for advice. And, you know, Dr. Cowboy makes this point like, well, hey, you know, I'm okay with you letting her go if you're okay with her killing people.
I mean, because he's like, I'm your imaginary friend. I can't tell you what's right or wrong. All, yeah, I can do is almost be your yes man, if you will.
Yeah, exactly. And from there, things take a very dark turn. And, you know, Dr. Cowboy tells Vic that he'll always be this pathetic little boy that will never grow up. And that's ultimately what leads Vic into falling victim to the Candlemaker and being coated in wax, yeah, as it turns out. So that's pretty much where we leave Cyborg until next season, whenever that is. So then we had Roxy, Mademoiselle Roxy with Roxy. Rita. And so what did you make of Rita's imaginary paper doll come to life?
It was rather creepy. I'm rather disturbing. I will give you that. Especially the eyes, I thought, were very creepy. And they animated her in there. The CGI effects were great because it kind of, yeah, made her look very otherworldly, as she should look.
Yeah.
And
like a giant life-size paper doll.
Yeah. The effect was just fantastic. And I guess you see where you go. You said, you know, the fact of Vic having daddy issues. Here, of course, we have Rita's mommy issues personified, literally, because she then tells us that, you know, she actually cut out the eyes, which were her mom's, from a picture that she'd seen, and used them for Roxy's eyes. So, you know, it shows you how much, you know, also she looked up to her mom.
Which is all kinds of messed up on its own, I think.
It is. Rita probably has to talk to somebody about the fact that cutting out her mom's eyes and using them, it's like...
Yes.
There is
Just a bit.
There is something slightly there, slightly wrong. But no, and I thought it was so weird that they would actually end up doing like a tip-tap dance-off.
Yeah, it's almost like something out of Mary Poppins, this kind of duet where Rita's kind of like dancing on stage. Yeah. With her imaginary friend, and so you have like Rita dancing and the paper dolls dancing, and you know, Roxy's trying to be confident, or you know, like her complimentary. She says that Rita still got it and everything, and then once again, you know, things take that little darker turn. You know, Rita talks about how she crumpled up Roxy because of what her mother did to get her that role. Yeah. And that was essentially when Rita decided that she didn't need Roxy anymore and discarded her. And Roxy isn't exactly, you know, she talks about that too, that Roxy was the last thing she wanted to be. And then once again, I think you have the Candlemaker trying to speak through Roxy a little bit in telling Rita that she became what she didn't want to be, desperate and willing to do anything to get that next role. So essentially she became her mother in a lot of ways.
Which I thought was an interesting commentary, almost because the fact that they say that almost Rita has to play a role because she's an empty person, which I thought was, it's an interesting also analysis to look at it that way, that she constantly needs to play a role because she's not a whole person without that. So she almost...
Like a blank slate, almost, without that. Yeah.
Yeah, everything she does, it's not her. She's playing something. And so, you know, she's basically acting. Her life is one big movie, if you will, where she's playing a character that's not necessarily her. So I love that dark commentary in the way the Candlemaker sees it. And all these imaginary friends coming out, you know, I had used this comparison for Red Jack, but here once again, I get the It vibe very much so as well, because It will show you your biggest fears, but he will also tantalize you with things you might feel secure with. And then, boom, you know, once you feel safe and happy, it suddenly turns into that murderous clown.
Well, I think that despair probably feeds off that despair because, hey, it's essentially I'm setting you up to knock you down. Yeah. And that's kind of what the Candlemaker does here, is that it starts to be very complimentary. And then just like with Vic, then it just kind of pulls that rug out and watches, in this case, Rita fall. And she succumbs also, just like Vic, becoming, you know, encased in wax. So essentially it's like... that it's that moment, I think, that the Candlemaker gets his hooks in, into their soul, if you will. And at that moment, they fall victim to the Candlemaker's trap.
Yeah. It's just like I said, just like when It kind of traps the kids in the sewer because he preys on their fear. And that's how the Candlemaker works, sure.
Yeah. And lastly, of course, we have Cliff with imaginary Jesus. So this is a little bit more humorous, at first at least, where Jesus shows up as the one who confronts Cliff. Cliff is kind of puzzled by this at first. He's like, look, you were like all of my friend for like all of half a summer because I was at Bible camp because my parents made me. But Cliff is like, you know, the Jesus is insistent, like, well, look, I'm here to end you. So this is obviously right off the bat, it's not the Jesus, and you know, it's a, you know, like he's intending on essentially taking Cliff off the board. So he's a little more upfront than the other imaginary friends. So what did you make of? I know that obviously this is a very controversial for a lot of people, So, yeah. So I'm guessing you have one or two thoughts on that.
Well, my first question is, Charles, because I've seen that in, because obviously in America you have freedom of speech and freedom to express yourself creatively.
Right.
And of course, I have seen Jesus depicted both in South Park and in Family Guy and all this kind of thing. And I don't know how many people complain about that, because evidently, I guess in the States, you can depict Jesus and it's not considered blasphemous. Is that the way it is?
Well, you have religious groups that consider it blasphemous and they get upset and they try to write letters or, you know, email or try to get sponsors to pull their advertising.
Hmm.
But in a lot of ways, I think a lot of advertisers just tune that out now because they know it's coming. It doesn't have the impact anymore. There's a group here in the States called 1 Million Moms that was doing a lot. They even pressured writers like Neil Gaiman about things. But the 1 Million Moms were essentially turned out to be like maybe all of 10,000 people.
Right.
Like a slight underestimate there. And as a result, you know, that they think that they're more powerful than they really are. They're just outraged people. And so as a result, because, you know, there's, especially nowadays, we have this, you know, this quick, you know, like instant out, you know, like the instant outrage over something there. It's, you know, something so trivial can just be blown up into the biggest, you know, drama or controversy. And as a result, they tend to lose their impact, I think, is that people become desensitized to them. And so they don't have as much power as they like to think they do.
No, because I was just wondering that, because I'm obviously not a Christian, so it doesn't faze me. But I just wonder, you know, though I have a feeling, I don't know how many people who watch Doom Patrol are actually fervent Christians. I don't know. There could be some. I'm not saying that the people who do watch Doom Patrol don't have any faith whatsoever.
Right.
But evidently they must be open-minded in their faith if you watch Doom Patrol.
Yeah.
I thought it was a fun depiction of Jesus, let's be honest. I mean, I did not find it offensive, but then again, this comes from somebody who is not a Christian.
I mean, I could see where people would be offended by it. I understand that, but I think if there's someone who watches Doom Patrol, they're probably not going to be someone who is offended by that. They would have been offended by something far worse earlier in the show.
That's what I'm saying is they're probably people of faith who watch this, but they're not like, oh, he said the dirty word.
Exactly. They would have been offended. They would have turned off the TV once they heard Cliff dropping F-bombs every other sentence.
That's right. So that's why I think it probably the crowd it caters to is not that kind of crowd.
Right. It's essentially the same type of audience that appreciates Preacher. Which obviously a lot of people found controversial because it really pushes the boundaries of you know, what's considered tasteful criticism of Christianity.
Yeah.
So it's one of those boundary pushers. So like South Park, like Family Guy, like you're talking about. Although personally, I think South Park did it better than Family Guy.
I agree.
I think their satire is a lot stronger than Family Guy's.
Oh yes, well, Family Guy is almost meek compared to what South Park gets away with.
Exactly.
But that aside, I thought it was fun. I enjoyed it. I was just like, wow, Cliff is taking a pounding here because the guy knocks out his eye, he rips his arm off. It's like, whoa, you know, how is Cliff going to get when he ripped his arm off? I'm like, how in the world is he going to replace that? I don't see you replacing that arm.
I told you got to put your money on Jesus. I'm just saying. He's tricky. You know, he's tricky in a fight. He's wiry. So that's
good. Yeah. Quite an impressive roundhouse kicks too.
Yeah. He's got some mad skills, you know, and, you know, he's good at like, he, you know, he rips Clip's arm off, uses it as a club against him. So beats the poor guy up with his own arm. How sad is that?
Idiot.
So it's a bad look for Cliff. Let's just say. Now, granted, okay, he's going up against Jesus, but still a bad look. I gotta think. being beaten up with your own arm.
Yeah, and he's like, shouldn't you be all peaceful and all this kind of thing?
Yeah. I mean, and it was funny because, you know, Cliff at the first part, he's just like, look, let's talk this out peacefully here. Like, I don't want to fight with Jesus. And Jesus is like, too bad. I'm here to, like, you know, to end you. And then they throw down. So it's pretty funny. Funny for Cliff, but funny for us.
I mean, I'm sure you've seen your share of Jesus's depictions throughout on various.
Well, South Park is a great example because, you know, they did one episode in South Park where they had like Jesus in a boxing match against Satan or something, and it was very funny. So that didn't bother me, but then again, I have kind of a twisted sense of humor, so. Maybe I'm not the best example. I don't know. So I understand, you know, I respect people who are offended by that. But personally, I would advise that, hey, it's, you know, like a lot of things, you should just not take it so seriously and just try to, you know, it's you still have your faith no matter what. It's not going to change anything. If your faith is that weak, let's just put it this way. I feel that if your faith is that weak that you feel threatened by something you saw on a superhero TV show, then I think there's more to be concerned about than said superhero TV show.
Very well said. And plus, I don't think it's blatantly, you know, racist or anything of that nature or prejudiced in any way. It's not an open attack against Christianity.
No.
You know, I'd understand if it were, but it's not. It really isn't.
And to the show's credit, they don't, you know, Cliff, you know, says you're not the real Jesus. They state that off the bat, that this isn't the real Jesus. This is just, you know, an imaginary friend that Cliff had perceived as a child. So his, in coming from a character like Cliff, his outlook is definitely different.
But it's also very clever on the show's part because it calls off the million moms of the world, I think.
Yeah, but I mean, you're still going to, like, you probably still have people being outraged by it. I'm sure if you did a hashtag Doom Patrol search, you probably would find some people expressing some dissatisfaction with that, but thankfully I think those people are few and far between these days.
I agree with
you. So that's just my take, but and I know you have your take. So
yeah, it was pretty creepy when he turned around and said, I'm not Jesus. I was like, whoa.
Right, exactly. It's the Candlemaker, so it's just the Candlemaker appearing to Cliff as Jesus. So there's really, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, there's nothing to be upset about, but again, I understand some people might. So
it's not the Jim Caviezel Jesus.
No, you know? No. Yeah, exactly. This isn't Passion of the Christ. This is Doom Patrol, for crying out loud. Yeah. Let's just keep in perspective a little bit. All right. That's my advice anyway. And anything else about these characters?
No, these fights were great. It was just a great lead up. I was just, you know, kind of looking at the run time, saying how much more do we have of this, you know, before I have to kind of say goodbye.
Yeah, I was watching the clock too. I'm going like, okay, how are they gonna end this, because this is all we get. So I was very worried about that ending. So we might as well face that head on in our fourth topic.
Yeah.
As I tried to segue into that.
Very well done. Yes, let's face the music.
Exactly. Let's, you know, let's take a deep breath, calm ourselves down, and let's talk about the Chief Slava, who makes a return here, Dorothy and the Candlemaker. And the Candlemaker is large and in charge in this episode. Makes his presence known to everyone, as we saw, because his systematic dismantling of the Doom Patrol through imaginary friends. And now he's focused on Dorothy. And so this is what everything the Chief has been fearing from the get-go, ever since we found out that he had a daughter, is coming to pass. It's not looking good. You half expect the Ghostbusters to show up at any point with their proton packs.
Or the sex men.
Or the sex men, exactly. That's a good point. That's a very good point. Maybe having to put a little overtime in on this one. But yeah, so it's not looking good for Team Doom Patrol in this one. So what did you make of how this episode concluded?
Okay, all I can say is yes, there was a big, big sigh, and it was kind of like, and a series of no's going on. I was like, no!
You can't leave me here, no.
Yeah, it was terrible, because I do like the fact that, yes, Dorothy did embrace her womanhood, if you will. You know, she put her big girl boots on, literally, and fashioned her own weapon. It's like, you know, I'm ready to do this, and we kind of just get, you know, the Candlemaker reaching out and grabbing her and taking her into that fire, that, you know, pyre, if you will. And
that bonfire, yeah.
Yeah, and yeah, I was just left, you know, this, because I said to myself, there's so much going on, because in the middle of that you had, it was ramping up in the underground of Miranda not being Miranda and all that. Yeah.
So you get this big revelation with that Miranda is not really Miranda and is actually Daddy. That bombshell drops, and then, you know, they're cutting back and forth between, you know, that sequence and then the bit with Dorothy and the Candlemaker, and you see poor Dorothy essentially, you know. We know that Niles is already dying because, you know, he doesn't have his immortality anymore, and he's helpless to do anything about what's transpiring at this point, because it's all he can do to keep breathing at this point. Poor Dorothy, you know, now she's, you know, we talked about how she had her period last episode. She's become a woman, so to speak, and, you know, and it's essentially this is the Candlemaker's moment. He's making his move. And, you know, Dorothy comes out, sees the Doom Patrol covered in wax, and is horrified by that. The Candlemaker is just, you know, has put it on, putting all the blame on Dorothy. Says, look, you know, the only reason I'm doing this is because of you. You're the one that's causing all their pain.
Right.
So Dorothy is taking all of this. She even says to her father that, you know, she's the one who did it. It's all on her for making that wish and allowing the Candlemaker to cross dimensions into this one. Mm-hmm. And Niles is still insistent that they could somehow fix everything, that they can stop this. So it's this big climactic moment. And and then, you know, we see Slava turn up, saying that, you know, trying to say that Dorothy is now a woman, and offers her a spear. But Dorothy says, no, I can make my own. That's and right. And she actually manifests her own weapon to use against the Candlemaker, and she willingly allows herself to be taken in by the Candlemaker.
Niles watches on.
Yeah, obviously he's helpless. He feels like, you know, he still sees Dorothy as a little girl. So he, you know, he sees her as a falling victim. But Dorothy, this is where I think the chief is not putting enough faith in his daughter. Dorothy feels that she's ready to face the Candlemaker at long last. Mm-mm. So what do you think?
I'm definitely more on Slava's side in this case than Niles is, because she's the one who says she's ready and all this. And while Niles is kind of yelling at Slava, saying, why did you allow this to happen? You
know, yeah, he's blaming her for cursing their daughter.
So rather, while she's keeps saying she's ready, and as you said, if he loves her so much, he could show a little bit of faith, because we can see in Dorothy's conviction that she knows she's got this, or rather she feels she's got this.
Yeah.
And I think also she wants to, in her own way, atone for what's happened. Granted, it's not necessarily on her, but she feels she has to rectify the situation, and so she decides to go in and, you know, ultimately sacrifice herself, because we don't know what the outcome will be of this battle.
Yeah.
So she might ostensibly end up her having to sacrifice herself to save everybody else. But it was great. It was just such a huge cliffhanger, and I was just so upset when the credits rolled. You know, we cut to black,
Yep.
And the credits rolled. I was like, no, you can't do this to
me.
And I was kind of looking, yeah.
No!
That's right. I was
you,
kind
you,
of
you
almost...
do that Darth Vader in Revenge of the Sith. Going, no!
Yeah, I was just, so I was almost, part of me was almost hoping that, you know, I don't know, there might actually be another episode which was aired somewhere on the dark web or what have you, and it might be there. But no, I was really depressed. I was upset because there's so much going on. And I look, granted, there will be a panel in September, so that usually bodes well, because I don't know if they'd go to a panel saying, guys, it was fun, we're not coming back ever again, goodbye.
Yeah.
I don't think they would be so cold-hearted.
We don't know what exactly how well Doom Patrol is doing on HBO Max, but I have to think, you know, the show's pretty considered by a lot of fans to be very well done, a very well-made show. And hopefully, you know, especially with maybe, you know, it's to the show's benefit that they had this cliffhanger, because maybe it'll help public demand for that season 3. So that if, you know, Warner Media or HBO Max is kind of, if they're waffling on this, I don't know that they would be, but if for whatever reason they are, that maybe this would help tip the scales in that renewal favor.
Yeah, and I think also, like The Boys, for example, this show caters to a lot of people who are not necessarily superhero movie fans. Because I have a lot of friends out there who are not necessarily, you know, fans of the MCU or the DCEU or what have you, but they love Doom Patrol and they love The Boys. They love this more edgy.
Or the Umbrella Academy.
Or the Umbrella Academy, other great example. It's these kind of shows that they love. I mean, there's a friend of mine who's only watched the two Deadpool movies because he thought Deadpool was so edgy and so cool, but he won't give the MCU the time of day or the DCU the time of day. He's like, I want a certain style of film, he says to me. And that's why he loves Deadpool, Doom Patrol, The Boys, Umbrella Academy. So I think you have quite a good varied audience, because you have the geeks like us who love the superhero movie fare, and you have a damn about that stuff but love the show.
Yeah, exactly. There is definitely an audience for offbeat superhero fare. I think that was pretty much evident if you've ever since probably Hellboy in 2004.
Yeah, that really kind of broke the mold.
You know, that it was something different. It wasn't just a straightforward superhero versus supervillain. You had a very non-traditional hero in the case of Hellboy being, you know, like a hell demon as the hero. So
yeah, well, the Watchmen's, the Blades,
right,
those kind of films.
Yeah, so there is that audience, and I kind of consider myself part of that audience, even though I'm someone who also appreciates traditional superheroes.
Yeah.
But I also like me some quirky superheroes too. And Doom Patrol definitely fills that void in spades. And hopefully HBO Max is wise enough. The suits at HBO Max are wise enough to recognize this.
I hope so. I mean, they took away City of Angels, which I'm so upset about.
I was going to talk to you about that. I saw that cancellation, that it only got canceled after only one. And it ended on a cliffhanger as well.
Yeah, I was gutted when I saw that. Really gutted, because I'd invested a lot in, you know, emotionally in that show. And sadly, I won't get a return on my investment. So that's how it goes.
No, but, one done, unfortunately.
Yeah, so guys, don't take Doom Patrol away from us. Already you've taken City of Angels away from me. Don't take Doom Patrol away. But
you go too far, sirs. Too far.
Yeah, too far, too far.
This is the line, and it shall not be crossed. You shall not pass.
Thank you, Gandalf. I like that. But when it comes to you, Charles, I mean, what did you make of this ending? Were you satisfied with it?
Yeah, I'm a Twin Peaks fan, so I know all about frustrating cliffhanger endings.
True.
You know, that's our trademark if you're a Twin Peaks fan, especially looking at you, season 2 finale and season 3 finale. just saying. So as frustrating as it is watching this finale, I'm still hopeful. I'm going at it with the hope that, yes, we will get that season 3. I feel pretty confident about it. I think there's enough demand, and you know, I see Twitter and I see the reactions, so I have to think HBO Max sees those tweets as well, because that's what they're interested in. They want that online engagement from the audience. Mm-hmm. And so that's what they're looking at. And I think with Doom Patrol, you know, they'll see that. And so I feel confident it's going to come back. So the ending didn't really frustrate me, especially knowing, well, hey, there was going to be another episode. It was just truncated because of the COVID-19 crisis, with production shutting down. So mm-hmm. I think, you know, it feels a little hollow. It feels incomplete. Especially when, you know, like, hey, we're building up to this finale, and then not being able to see that finale right away is very frustrating. But at this point, there's not a lot we can do. So I'm more resigned to it. And you know, it's frustrating and it's disappointing, but, again, there's not a whole lot we can do about it, and especially until production resumes.
Well, you took it with great philosophy there, I think, Charles.
Maybe really because I'm older, I try to be a little bit wiser, and maybe I don't always succeed, but I'm a little more pragmatic about things like this.
Yeah, I saw you're very zen, because I guess you look at it, you know, there is a silver line that, and there, I'm not hoping not jinxing it here, but at least it wasn't canceled, you know?
Yeah. No, I mean, if anything, you know, I think shows like Titans have more to worry about than Doom Patrol at this point.
Yeah. So. They really have their socks to pull up and then some, you know. Yeah. If folks, you know, definitely check out our both Jesse and Charles's review of those seasons and also the recaps we did, because, and you'll see why we say this.
Exactly. So we'll see. We'll see what happens, but I feel pretty confident that we'll get that season 3 pickup, and hopefully we'll get the announcement next month at DC Fandome.
So, he's hoping.
All right. Anything else about this episode?
No, all in all, I just loved it. As I said, there were all the makings of a penultimate episode, you know, and obviously we saw this coming. It did what it had to do. There was so much going on. The review of Daddy being Miranda, I thought, was a great one.
Yep.
And the fact that we get to see what will ostensibly be the showdown between Dorothy and the Candlemaker is going to be great to see. And you wonder where they're going to have this showdown.
Yeah, I think for a penultimate episode, I think we got it. You know, there's a lot of deep stuff going on in this one. We've talked about a lot of deep subjects. So we'll see what happens. All right. Favorite quotes. Do you have any favorite quotes? There's some good lines in this one. So.
I do have a few. You know, we mentioned Jesus. Well, the exchange between Cliff and Jesus, where Cliff's like, Jesus? And he's like, hey, Cliffy, you piece of shit. And Cliff's like, what the F? You were my imaginary friend for like half a summer at Bible camp. And he's like, yeah, then you forsook my ass. So that was kind of funny.
That was good.
Then also Rita with Roxy, and Rita looks at Roxy and says, what's going on here? I assume you're going to, what, attack me? Try to rip me limb from limb? I feel I should warn you. I have certain abilities now, abilities I didn't possess as a child. Stretchy abilities, blobby abilities. They're really quite something.
That was great. I love that. I actually wrote that one down. That was good.
And the last one is, we mentioned it, the Cliff, and Cliff is wanting to wear a T-shirt. And Cliff says, Clara's getting married, and somehow, for the grace of sweet baby Jesus, I scored the ticket. And I was like, and you're going to wear a T-shirt? Which will be fine. I mean, everyone will be looking at the bride anyway. And Cliff's like, I'm having a hard time picking one out. I'm going for the most clean and less offensive.
It was great. I still almost wish there was a Robot Man spinoff, because I could just watch Cliff all the time.
You and me both. If that it gets announced that in September, I'll be a very, very happy Doom Patrol fan.
Yeah, I don't see it being announced, but I would not have a problem with that if it did. Mm. Far from it. Yeah. All right, my quotes are Cliff telling everyone, well, Grandpa is off to go see my baby girl do that thing that is usually the biggest mistakes of people's lives. So that was good. Cliff, when they arrive at the fair, going, okay, So we teleported up Walt Disney's asshole. Now what?
Very well put.
And a great one. Let's see. I kind of got to have... I'll make this one my last one. So Cliff, and more of a Cliff and imaginary Jesus, where Cliff says, "Wait, Jesus, I come in peace. Maybe we could talk this out." And imaginary Jesus replies, "You think I give a French fried titty F about anything you have to say right now? Cliff, I'm here to end you."
Boom. I like that one. Yeah, that was good. Yeah.
But and then on a side note, Cliff with Larry, Cliff going like, "What the F?" And Larry replying, "For the first time, I agree with Cliff. What the F?"
I like that one. That was cool.
That was good. All right, so what's your rating?
I'm going to give this an 8.5 out of 10 imaginary Jesuses.
Nice. I wrote that down, but I also wrote another one because I had a feeling you might take that one.
Oh, well, see, that was great foresight on your part.
So we're in sync in this last episode here of Doom Patrol Season 2. I give it 8.5 out of 10 pairs of red boots.
Nice.
Because
very
if you
nice.
Notice, they made a big Wizard of Oz reference with Dorothy as she's kind of like stepping up to the plate. You know, she manifests her spear and Slava gives her red boots. These kind of like red moccasin style boots.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously a nod to Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz with the red ruby slippers.
Yep.
And so we'll see what happens. But don't think I didn't notice those red boots.
That was great, yeah.
Yeah, that was good. All right. So Titans Tower, we got some Titans Season 3 news out of DC Fandom. Ooh, so I'll run that down quickly. We just got a little bit. Unfortunately, we did get a air date. Unfortunately, they still haven't made the thing yet, so it's going to be a long wait for Titans Season 3. Mm-hmm. Still, even though we've been waiting for Titans Season 3. It's going
to
be even longer.
To add to our laundry list of things we're waiting for.
Exactly, exactly. So at the DC Fandom Hall of Heroes event, the Titans panel that they had revealed that Jason Todd will become Red Hood in Season 3.
Ooh,
so
nice.
Now it's going to be a little different from, obviously, they're not going to have the Joker, so it's not going to be a case of Jason getting crowbarred and killed and then resurrected and then becoming the Red Hood, like he is in the comics.
Yeah, we won't get a Death of a Family under the Red Hood storylines, of course. But yeah.
But I'm sure, and he's going to be apparently taking revenge on the Titans.
So there might be a bit of an under the Red Hood storyline.
Maybe, at least at first. Mm. You know, and maybe they'll have to redeem him a little bit. Maybe Dick will lure him back from the dark side. And then, we'll see what happens there. Barbara Gordon, who we knew was going to be appearing in Titans Season 3, is going to be confirmed as the commissioner of the Gotham City Police Department.
Which I'm really looking forward
to. So she'll be taking over for her father, James Gordon, who I'm guessing may be dead at this point. We don't know what happened to Jim Gordon. Scarecrow will be turning up. Dr. Jonathan Crane will be an inmate at Arkham Asylum, but he'll also have a second career as a profiler for the GCPD. So maybe a little Silence of the Lambs thing going on here.
I hope so, because if played right, Scarecrow can be a great character.
Yeah, and so apparently the show's going to be essentially relocating from San Francisco to Gotham City. Mm. So essentially, Titans is embracing themselves as, or rebranding themselves as another Batman TV show.
Pretty much, yes.
At least this season, they are. So if you're a little frustrated by all the, like, heavy Batman references, maybe you want to see more Titans-related stuff, you're probably going to be even more frustrated Season 3.
I have a feeling, yes.
So we'll see. But Scarecrow's pretty cool. Barbara Gordon's cool.
Agreed.
So we're going to get Red Hood at long last in live action. We've been waiting, waiting for that.
Yeah.
So we'll see how it turns out. But unfortunately, like I said, we don't have much other news. Now, DC Fandom is going to be doing their, you know, we had the movie panels. So the TV panels will be Those will be on Saturday, September 12th, when DC Fandom returns. And yes, it's going to include a Doom Patrol panel, and reportedly it's going to include an extended Titans panel. So maybe we'll learn a little bit more. Maybe by then they'll be able to announce a date there as well. Fingers crossed.
Yeah, which I'm sure there are people waiting for, indeed.
Yeah. Or at least, you know, confirmation that, official confirmation that we will get season 3 for both shows.
And look, if they're giving Titans another chance, and as I said, the two seasons have been great, good, but not great. You think they would give Doom Patrol a third season?
Yeah, and it would be my guess that with DC Universe pretty much on its last legs at this moment, that Titans will also be making the shift over to HBO Max.
Yeah, I believe they're kind of packing, covering the furniture as we speak, Charles.
Pretty much, yeah. It's like, it's all over but the shouting at this point.
Yeah.
And I was kind of surprised, honestly, that we didn't get an announcement about DC Universe at Fandome. But maybe in September we will.
Well, maybe they're figuring out contracts and what have you, and they don't want to make anything official just yet.
I'm sure there's some logistics issues that need to be worked out with that.
Yeah.
Transferring everything over, making sure all the legalese is addressed. So we'll see. So that's some news. We got some feedback. We got two feedbacks this week.
Ooh, nice.
So we have two people telling it to Titan Talk this time. First and foremost, of course, we have Holly Mack writing in once again.
Hey, Holly.
I know we're running long, but hey, it's our finale, right? So who cares, right?
Exactly. Give us a break, people.
Yeah, exactly. So indulge us a little bit. So Holly writes in and says, hey, Charles and Nick. Hey, Holly.
Hey, Holly.
Hard to believe we're in the final episodes of Doom Patrol Season 2. It seems like we just started. I know, right? Because we did just start like 2 months ago. So, and it's over already, just like that. So,
like a Thanos snap, if you will.
Yeah, I can't do it. I got to have trigger fingers, so I got like one of my snapping fingers.
I saw what you did there, though, sir, and I appreciate the little shout out.
I tried. Larry suggesting to Cliff that he might not want to wear a T-shirt to his daughter's wedding seems like a very good piece of advice.
Thank you, Holly.
Yeah,
Thank you.
It is good advice, which will probably fall by the wayside. Unfortunately, with Cliff. I don't know how much I really trust Miranda. Well, yeah, especially at the end of this episode. Cliff's being stuck between a rock and a hard place, having to miss his daughter's wedding because of needing to save the Earth. Fingers crossed she will believe him. Yeah, I think we're all doing that right now. Crossing our robot fingers for Cliff. I think the others are getting tired of Miranda calling the shots and wanting Jane back, even if they haven't admitted it out loud. So, yeah, the music used in this episode was awesome. And, of course, the Candlemaker would use Team Doom Patrol's imaginary friends against them. Man, talk about a cliffhanger ending. I'll wrap it up here, Holly from Wisconsin.
Thank you, Holly. We love you.
Yeah, we do. And, Holly, you've been so wonderful. You've been writing in all season long as we've been going through Doom Patrol Season 2. So I want to give you a special thanks from both of us. You were fantastic. We loved having you on for an episode. And maybe hopefully if we ever get Doom Patrol Season 3, hopefully we'll have you back.
I would, you know, as the kind of the new addition to this podcast, Charles, I would like to put forward my vote as well for having Holly back for sure.
Yeah, she's wonderful. She's such a lovely woman. So kind to us, so supportive of all the stuff we do. So definitely check out Holly on the Five-ish Fangirls podcast. She's good people. And,
she certainly is.
And we want to return her kindness to us. So
we certainly do.
So thank you, Holly. And lastly, I got an email. I want to show this to you. I don't know if you can see it, Nick. Obviously, it's going to be a little tough maybe, but I got an email from the Batman.
Oh, wow. Really? Batman listens to this podcast? How cool is that?
How cool is that, right? Now, so actually what it is, it's we got an email from Chris from Colorado. So, hi, Chris. Though it's kind of funny because his header on Gmail, on Google, you know, he's got an icon picture of Batman, and the header says the Batman. So you look at the email and you're like, oh my God, I got an email from Batman. How cool is that, right?
So have we just outed his identity here, Charles?
Yeah. Oh, that's true. Oops.
Sorry.
everybody forget what I just said. whoops. All right. That's a good point. So, not the Batman, but Chris from Colorado writes in. So Chris writes in, hi, Charles and Nick. Hi, Chris. Shout out to Jesse. So I'm sure Jesse appreciates that. We have not forgotten about Jesse by a long shot.
Of course not.
Of course not. He's still with us. So I've been listening to you guys since season one of Titans and thought it was finally time to send you an email! Exclamation mark. So yay! So Chris, thank you so much for listening, especially being a longtime listener. We really appreciate
exactly.
that. That's great. And it's great that you stuck with us. And,
appreciate your loyalty, for sure.
Yeah, and we hope we keep entertaining you. So thank you for that, my friend. He goes, I have two questions for you guys. Do you think the personality in Miranda is Daddy?
Yeah, that's a hard yes from me.
Pretty much. Oh, hell yes from me. You know, in that Will Smith tone. Oh, hell yes. Yeah.
Yes. CCC, as they say over here in Italy.
So, yes. I know that takes precedence in the comics. So I'm not sure where it does.
Me either. I mean, you're the
I know.
Here,
I should know. If it does, I should know that. So, Chris, you might have to write in and tell me where you saw that, because now I want to see where that happened. Maybe I missed something. So I'm perfectly willing to admit that, and maybe I overlooked something. Also, do you think we will see a physical manifestation of the Candlemaker? Well, we kind of did, didn't we?
I suppose so, yeah, because now he has broken through to reality, and I think he's no longer just an imaginary friend of Dorothy. So I'd say the last shots we get when he emerges from the fire is him breaking into our world, I would say, Charles. I mean, do you agree with that?
Yeah, I think so, okay, because you had the chief seeing Dorothy be pulled into the fire by the Candlemaker.
Yeah.
And remember, you know, in the flashbacks, the chief saw the Candlemaker, which is why he's been so afraid of the Candlemaker returning.
Yeah.
So, you know,
he's finally released his bonds from the imaginary world.
Yeah. So I think that was the physical manifestation there.
I do too.
So that's our take on that. Just want to say thank you all so much for what you do. I look forward to both Phantom Zone and Titan Talk every week. Oh, it's the highlight of my day.
Aww.
That's awesome. So thank you. Thank you, Chris, for all the kind words there.
You're up, Chris.
And now I feel really guilty because, hey, Doom Patrol Season 2 is over. So, you know, it's not our fault. It's not our fault.
Don't hold it against us. We'll think of something, but don't hold it against us.
Yeah, we're going to have to be very creative, aren't we? Hope you stay safe and healthy during these tough times. Best wishes, Chris from Colorado.
Back at you, Chris.
Thank you. Yes, exactly. We want you to stay safe because we want you to keep listening to us. And keep up the good fight against those bad guys in Gotham City, my friend.
Agreed. And also congratulations to your Avalanche, if you're an Avalanche fan, Chris, because your Colorado Avalanche made it through to the next playoff round, unlike my Canadians and Charles's Blue Jackets. So
you had to bring that up. You had to twist the knife in my side.
It makes two of us, but hey, at least the Avalanche affords some. So if Chris is an Avalanche supporter, he'll be happy because at least they're still going.
Yeah, we don't know if you're a hockey fan, Chris, but unfortunately, both Nick's team and the Montreal Canadiens and my team, the Columbus Blue Jackets. Bum, 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 bum.
Yeah, they're playing golf right now, if they can play golf. epic fails. I think they're playing golf or they're enjoying time with their families during COVID, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. That's, I guess, the upside for them is that maybe they can spend time with their families now, I guess. But doesn't really do us any good, does it?
No.
So thank you, Holly. Thank you, Chris, for writing in. Anybody, in the meantime, if you want to write in, we'd love to hear from you. Even if, you know, I still get the emails, even if we're not putting out episodes. So You have any thoughts about our reviews, or especially our you know, the last episode of Doom Patrol here for season two, or just anything else, drop us a line, TitanTalkCast@gmail.com. That's TitanTalkCast@gmail.com. Or you can reach out to us on Twitter @TitanTalkCast, where as soon as there's any news, you know, we'll be happy to post that. Or on Facebook, Titan Talk, the Titans Podcast. You'll get all the news there as well as soon as it comes out. So definitely you want to keep in touch with us. Nick, where can they reach you?
Well, when it comes to me, for you country music lovers, I do host the Whiskey and Cigarettes show where we play traditional country, today's country, and everything else in between. For more about that and how and where to tune in, you can visit our website. That's whiskeyandcigarettesshow.com. When it comes to podcast land, when I'm not here hanging out with my good buddy Charles on Titan Talk, you can, if superhero movies are your speed, you can check us out on Happiness and Darkness, a superhero movie podcast, where Charles recently joined me to celebrate our 50th episode of where we reviewed Endgame, and we had a ball doing that.
That was a lot of fun.
Definitely. And of course, if you guys would like to join me on there and discuss a superhero of your choice, you can send me an email at happinessanddarknesshal@gmail.com. We'll supply you with a list of films to cover. Also, you can find us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And also, another great podcast, our latest project, Gold Standard, the Oscars movie podcast, where with mutual friends, Sam Sprouse and Rachel Friend, we're reviewing all the movies that won the Oscar for Best Picture in chronological order from 97's Wings to the present day. Thursday, September 3rd, we'll be discussing the seventh film to win Best Picture, which will be It Happened One Night with the great Clark Gable. If you'd like to share your thoughts in writing on that movie or would like to join us for that discussion, shoot us an email at goldstandardoscars@gmail.com. You can also follow us on Twitter and Facebook when it comes to that podcast as well. And what about you, Charles?
I love it when you do that. I'm going to miss that so much.
Hey, we'll come back. No fear. You haven't got rid of me yet, sir.
All right. Well, I hope not. All right. So as for me, of course, @CharlesSkaggs on the Twitter machine, @CharlesSkaggs on the Instagrams, Facebook, of course, Charles Skaggs in Hilliard, Ohio, and my blog of geeky things.
Damn good coffee and hot.
Damn good coffee and hot. We're talking about all the stuff we talk about here on Titan Talk, including Titans news, Doom Patrol news, DC Universe news, all kinds of comic book sci-fi news, news of my other podcasts that I do for Southgate Media, and including Deep Breath, Next Stop Everywhere, the Doctor Who podcast that I do with Jesse Jackson, and assorted special guest companions, including a certain DJ Nick you may have heard of, where we talk all kinds of classic Doctor Who, modern Doctor Who, Torchwood, Sarah Jane adventures. And yes, Nick will be returning later this year to Next Stop Everywhere. So definitely looking forward to that. We'll be talking some Ninth Doctor when he comes around. And hopefully we'll get him on a little sooner than that. Just stay tuned. Just warning everybody, stay tuned for that. The Phantom Zone podcast that I do with Jesse Jackson, where you know, we just finished up Stargirl from the DC Universe and the CW. We just finished up that series. Right now, we're kind of like in a transition. We may be doing a Lucifer Season 5A review episode. And I'm trying to get Jesse to talk some Umbrella Academy.
That makes two of us, Charles.
So everybody pressure Jesse to talk Umbrella Academy because I am dying to talk Umbrella Academy.
Yes, flood his email, his Facebook, and Twitter, and let him know.
pretty much. Here, I will give you his email. SetLustingBruce@gmail.com. So write to him. Say, you need to talk Umbrella Academy. And don't tell him we told you to do that. But anyway, so hopefully.
Hey, if he gets an email from Batman, he'll be happy.
Exactly. Batman. You know, Batman, if nothing else, should write Jesse and say, yeah, Chris in Colorado, you should be going, writing Jesse as Batman, going, like, I'm Batman. You need to talk Umbrella Academy. So, anyway. And then, of course, Ghost with the Twin Peaks podcast I do with Zan Sprouse, whom you just recently heard about, where we talk about all things Twin Peaks, David Lynch, and are currently going to be recording this week episode 2 of our 6-episode X-Files retrospective featuring Twin Peaks actors that have appeared on the X-Files including a certain David Duchovny you may have heard of once or twice, maybe. But we've talked David Duchovny. We talked the pilot in our previous episode. This week we're going to be talking about a certain Don Davis.
Nice.
Who on Twin Peaks was Major Garland Briggs, father of Bobby Briggs, and in X-Files is Captain William Scully, father of Special Agent Dana Scully, who meets a rather untimely end, but makes his presence known. So we'll be talking about that. So I get a great episode called Beyond the Sea. So I highly recommend checking it out. So everybody, thank you so much for listening to us on Titan Talk for Doom Patrol Season 2. Nick, I had a ball talking this with you. I'm so glad I got to do this. You know, we had plans. Jesse and I were going to talk about it, and then Jesse wasn't up for talking about it, and thankfully you agreed to join me here, and I'm so glad because that kind of gave us our own thing, and I was very grateful for that experience.
Well, Charles, I'm super thankful to you, for thinking of me and, inviting me on, making me a part of the Titan Talk family.
You're an official Titan Talker, sir.
I cannot, tell you how much that means to me. It really is. It's a joy and honor and a pleasure to be considered part of this wonderful family. You and Jesse are wonderful people, and yeah, I'm so appreciated, and I look forward to the next adventure, very much so.
So it may be a while before you reopen Titan's Tower or Doom Manor once again. Hopefully it won't be too long, and maybe in the interim, maybe we'll come up with some things to talk about, because we're probably going to go through some withdrawal, and I'm guessing we're going to be itching to talk about something along the lines. So if that's the case, we will come back for an episode 60 and share that with you guys. But in the meantime, thank you again for listening. Nick, thank you once again. And hopefully we won't be too long before we see all of you again here for Titan Talk, the Titans podcast. Goodbye, everybody.
Ciao.